Blog Talk Radio.
All praises to our Elohim, the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, Yitzhak, and Jacob. All praises. It's a great time to be alive. And we got a lot to talk about. So I'm going to try not to be all lengthy, but I'm going to try to get through it. Before we do that, a couple things. Last week's show, Brother L, just a pleasure, always is. When speaking to him and the other brethren and sisters that I communicate to, all praises for them, to them, and about and around them. I enjoyed it. We flowed in the spirit of the Father, and hopefully it showed. And people got something out of it. So, you know, I do feel that that by reviewing the comments section, it was there was some good comments, and the family was all about it. So that was filled with joy on that. This week, though, we're getting back to this study, and it's very, very interesting because, you know, when we look at what is happening in this time dispensation, this consummation of time, a few months ago, I said, you know, Father had me say, I should say, that we are going to begin to see a lot of confirmation, and they are going to begin to see a lot of revelation. And we are now in that time of consummation for us, where confirmation is a daily thing, momentary thing. It is a thing. It is a second by second, by moment thing, daily, weekly, monthly. And it's going to compound, and it's going to reach a crescendo right around April of next year. And that's going to be a completion of what I'm understanding, the wedding party, in terms of how the psyche, the brain. See, a lot of people, you know, in these camps and these other places and these other sisters and brothers who are part of these different groups, more power to you. I'm not against you. I'm not your enemy. Yet we have to understand that this is an individual scenario, because capitalism has done a hell of a job on our psyche. A hell of a job on our psyche. We were the dollar. Then we were able to get the dollar or a nickel or a dime and 15 or, you know, a dime and a nickel for 15 cents. And we didn't quite understand, because the entire time we were the ones that were bartering and being bartered and being sold. So that capitalism trick, or that capitalism faux pas, that philosophy, that principle has literally effed us up. And a lot of brothers and sisters in these groups, you know, their mindset is, you got to follow me because I'm the one that's telling you the truth. If you want to be, you know, a lot of them want to be priests and priestesses. Hey, listen. You don't get to make, I mean, you don't get to make that determination. And it would make more sense for you to be a soldier first to show your worth than you being a priest, because he, our Father, our Elohim, got rid of the priest for a specific reason. I know brothers and sisters be like, well, you know, there's still some around. Okay, that's fair. But I don't know where they at right now. They too are hidden and undercover. So for me to say to anybody, hey, you know, come follow me, I'll make you a priest, seems to me kind of fishy. And it seems to me like, hey, you follow me and I'll teach you what I know. instead of me following Yahusha or Yahuwah, our Elohim, and allowing their spirit to teach me. See, there's something wrong with this group scenario right now. Because from what I understand, the Father said for that he was going to gather us. So if somebody's out here gathering us, talking about, yo, you know, I got the way, I know the way, it sounds fishy too. That sounds, you know, if they say I'm over in the mountains or the desert or the wilderness, I ain't there. So my conceptualization of all of this is a simple fact of individualization. Now, why am I even going there? Because it's interesting. When I was doing some studying, I was like, yo, you know, I'd start thinking and start talking. Not talking, but I was thinking and I was, you know, going online, you know, putting some things in. And lo and behold, let's see. Before I do that, hold on. Because this is this is their fear and our joy. Don't do me no done favor.
by the nose of razor. Hey! Get ready! That's a banker! Get ready, you mother! Find a big payback!
I just, I was fancying that, and I was like, you know, but it's long, and I didn't want to go all the whole almost 8 minutes on it, but it was, it's the big payback. I mean, it's the big, big, big payback. It's up in, it's in store, it's the big payback, and, you know, that occurs on the individual level, and it occurs on the collective level. Something brother Judah said the other day, he was talking about the collective benefit and the collective punishment. And I had to write it down because it was very interesting to me to conceptualize that, because, you know, they've been running around, the nations have been running around talking about, you know, them individually and collectively from a beneficial perspective. Not one time have we heard anything about them from punishment. And that got me thinking. I was like, well, that's strange. Let's see. Is there any? Nope, nowhere. Nowhere. Because the victor goes to spoils. So you never hear about the punishment of the nations, because each time that one of them won, they became... they were in cahoots with each other. So, you know, Babylon to Assyria, right? And Assyria just took over Babylon. They just incorporated Babylon. And that's how they've been doing it. So they never once gained any punishment, which was really interesting to me in the concept of morality, karma. It was a very interesting thought, which then had me full circle to this, or rather full circle back to chess. My father had me see this. He said, listen, I know you talked about this before, but now I'm going to clarify some things. I'm going to clarify who I have left on the board. And I'm going to explain to you how I'm playing it. And I said, okay. And he said he has what he has left. Now the Gentiles have cheated and been adding pawns back on the board even after the father's taken them off, right? What he destroys, they're gonna think that they can rebuild. So he gave them time. So as they have, you know, cheated and put more pawns back on, all that was left on the father's pieces was one castle, two knights, a king, and a queen. That's it. Bishop's gone, and all the pawns are gone, okay? The castle, he told me, it signifies the kingdom. The two knights are the two witnesses. The queen is wisdom, and the king is Yahusha. Yahusha, our Messiah. And I thought long and hard on that, and I was like, wow, that's interesting that that's really all you need, Father. He was like, yeah, I ain't worried about them. He said, they have cheated and lied and robbed all of the chessboards. I said, all of the chessboards? He said, yeah, all the chessboards. And I was like, well, what does that mean? And he was, you know, he said, well, what it means is that when there's a stalemate, and right now there's a stalemate, on their end, they think that they have many moves to go, but it's my turn. The father said, it's his turn. It's his turn to go. They still think they have many moves, but I left them in limbo. I was like, okay, I'm starting to understand. He was like, I left them in limbo. So it's my move, my turn. And whenever, and this is true, whenever a chess game is left in limbo or a tie, but left in limbo, the father had me go and look this up. Do you know what they use to maybe determine a winner, but it could go on and on? Well, I'll tell you. It is a proxy game. A proxy game. So the big board, there's this in limbo. It's left in limbo. The two players are contemplating. They go, you know what? Let's hold this for a second, and let's play this proxy game over here on a smaller board on the same table. So this proxy game is being played, and let's say it too falls into limbo. Then they play another one, and they play another one until the table is full, hence the fullness of the Gentiles. What have they been doing this entire time but playing proxy wars? And why do I say that? Let's think about this. Okay, so Germany... So World War I was against Germany, and Germany lost. World War II was against Germany, and Germany lost. Pardon me. Okay, so... the World War. So here's these proxy wars that they have coined, they have propagandized to say World War, even though we know the background of all these wars have been because of a deception from a deceptive people. However, that said, there are these proxy wars. The World War I, Germany lost. World War II, Germany lost. But today, in November 22nd, 2023, if you look up, is Germany the largest economy in Europe? Germany is the fourth largest economy in the world, in the Gentile world, after the U.S., China, and Japan. And the largest economy in Europe. It is the third largest export nation in the world. At 70%, the service sector accounts for the largest share of the country's gross domestic product. How the hell? I thought they lost. Not once, but twice. Proxy. Limbo. Proxy. Proxy wars. Cold War proxy war. Korea proxy war. Vietnam proxy war. Because who won? What was gained? There was limbo. Proxy war. So these people have been playing chess against our father in limbo for a long time. And now their proxy, they have filled all their games, their proxy wars has filled the table. Now all that's left is them to come back to the original game. And the original game is the father's. And it's his move. So I got to thinking, I was like, wow, that's about, you know, okay. So I got to thinking and I was like, you know, based on the collective benefit and the collective punishment as well. But do you know, we, you know, not once... have these nations, have we as a people have never gained. Like there has not been any gain of us in anything that they have ever done throughout their history, and they have never lost. So the testimony of the nations, of the Gentiles, makes sense when Paul says, until the fullness of the Gentiles do come in. Because their fullness has to reach a point which is the fullness of their proxy wars, all their proxy madness. It has to be completed, which is the table's full. Now you got nowhere to go, no more games to be played. Come back and sit down at the table. It's the Father's move. And they have never had to, react us. We have always reacted off of them. So the Negro has been reacting off of the Gentile or the Israelite, or the Hebrew has been reacting off of the Gentiles for over a millennia now. Now how's that look? So they would do something, we had to react to it. They would do something, we had to react to it. They would do something, we had to react to it. All the way up until 2019. Then we began to act and watch them react. And now today, we don't even have to do that to watch their reaction. It's as if now our actions are like, so 7 years ago, we were at a point where we were learning. So within that 7 years from then to now, we've amassed a lot of knowledge, confidence, understanding, wisdom, understanding, and gained much, 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 much more wisdom than the nations ever had. Now, remember, they're not a moral people because capitalism does not allow for morality, okay? So anyway, so we have never, and we'll get back to that. We, up until now, or 7 years ago, like I said, we have been reacting off of them, okay? Now, we're watching so we're having conversations, just like last week, me and my homie are having conversations, we're talking, we're putting it on the airwaves. We're not even imposing anything onto them as they have done us. We're not even caring in the big scheme of things about anything that they're saying, doing, of any of their actions. We're holding a conversation. Now, fast forward to the other day, Judah is talking about Ish. Now they're reacting to what we're saying. They're on the back foot. It's an amazing thing to see. And listen, that isn't meaning, you know, James Brown said, you know, he's mad. You know, yeah, we mad. We were mad about it. You know, James was saying, you know, he needed a payback. Well, his spirit is restless because he really wanted that payback. That song, after they killed Malcolm and Martin, he just made that song. I believe. I believe that's true, but I can't recall, and I'm not looking that up right now. But the reality is that he made this song angry. He made an angry song and called it the payback. So his spirit was vexed, which means that his spirit has to be unvexed in the living and the dead. So now we're using it. So we're probably steering his spirit up. He's probably happy that the payback is coming. You know, for me, I'm indifferent. I truly am. I'm indifferent because, you know, at the end of the day, on one hand, they deserve this ass up. And on the other hand, you know, I have feelings for them taking an ass with me. Because you know, at the, because we would have healed Babylon, but she did not want to be healed. Let's get that real quick, and then we're going to move to the next thing. I mean, because, you know, it's just not hard. It's not hard. It's not even difficult to watch this. I mean, so Jeremiah 51:9, okay, but the whole chapter is quite telling. But 51:9, we would have cured. Now this is the Geneva. I said I'm going to read out of the Geneva Bible, the 1599 Geneva Bible tonight. So this says we would have cured Babel, but she could not be healed. Forsake her and let us go everyone into his own country, for her judgment is come up up into heaven and is lifted up to the clouds. Okay, so, you know, her stank, she's stanking now, you know, she nasty. And 10, the Lord hath brought forth our righteousness. Come and let us declare in Zion the work of the Elohim, our Elohim. So, you know, and you can see how they have hijacked. See, Zion is the land, but they hijacked it, made it a political faction, talking about Zionism. It doesn't even make sense. Yeah, you want one land, but the land's name is Zion. So you are trying to act as if you deserve a land of your own, even though your history shows you've been kicked out of every land that you were on. So the people didn't like you, and metaphysically and esoterically, the land didn't like your ass either. So how are you the people? And you can't force yourself back into the land if that's not written. You can't go and say, you know what, you know, I'm Jewish, and you know, I'm the chosen people, and you know, I get to force my way into any land in the world because I said so. That's not how it works. That's not even written. That's not even written. The way it goes down, mind you, Joel 3, right? Joel 3, 2. And this is an orderly thing. The Father is in order. Everything, and if you look at all the prophecies, all of them, there's an order to each thing that's happening. If you look at what's happening today, you can see the order of things. Now, they don't tell us what's going on all around the world, but we already know that there's fires, earthquakes, volcanoes, flooding, famines. We already know all this stuff is going on. Rumored wars, rumors of wars, proxy wars. See? Joel 3:2, I will also gather all nations and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat. And I will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage, Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. So they divvied up their land. So how is it they divvied up the Father's lands? So how is it that the Zionists want to turn around and just go take somebody's land? Oh, I get to take your land because I say this is where Jerusalem, this is where all of Israel was or is, and we want it, and we're going to take it. Not understanding that Israel is the people, idiots. Israel is the people. Zion is the land. Jerusalem over there is southern kingdom. Jerusalem over here, Guatemala, is northern kingdom. It only makes sense they're brothers, that they would have the same names. This is not even difficult anymore. And you know, I hear these brothers and I know these sisters, that they talk about Africa like it's the end all be all. But that's kind of foolish if you think about it, because what happened over here? What? Oh, these ain't nobody over here. What? My grandmother ain't never say she was African. She always said she was Cherokee, and she was dark. So I don't know what niggas is talking about. All from Africa. It seems to me that that is another vice to deceive us. Patience, and I'm going to let the Father work, because so far, all praise to the Father, and this has nothing, this is not, I have no power, no strength, I am no one yet. I'm batting 1,000%. 1,000. It's crazy. And I'm not even boasting on that. I'm just saying. I mean, I'm just looking at things going, thinking and then saying it, and then, you know, things is happening. But yet, ain't nothing I've said or seen said all Africa. Nothing. And again, I've done my due diligence. I went through the Khazarian, Germanic, Indo-European education system for history. Went to 3 colleges for that madness. Well, university, 2 universities and 1 college. First university, I got all of their information, all of their history. I got South Carolina history. I got North Carolina history. I got U.S. history. I got Civil War history. I got antebellum history. I got U.S. history. I got 1776 history. Civil rights history, blah, blah, blah. I went down to Clark and got ancient African, Timbuktu, Jene, Goa, connection to Greece, to Socrates, to Pluto, to Plato, to Webb, blah, blah, blah. Now, I'm very thankful that I did get that information. And this whole, and that whole time of understanding that, I recognized, hey, we are just something strange about us. And even Babylon and Timbuktu, you know, it touched on it. Okay, some of the southern kingdoms in West Africa, great. I mean, that makes sense. Judah, the Judeans stayed in the 3 parts. It only makes sense. It's not hard. It's not difficult. But to believe for a second that a foolish nation, as we see today, had the capabilities back then to undertake a logistical platform, global platform of relocation of people, get the boob out of here. I don't care. Like, it's just dumb logic to me. Is dumb. It's not reasonable based on their history. It's just not reasonable. What is reasonable, again, is them going from West Africa, Ghana, Mali, actually, to Brazil. What is Brazil today? Northwest around South America, on the coast, staying close to the coast. Now, when I say close to the coastline, I'm not saying that they at the beach. I'm saying, you know, maybe 100 feet, 100 miles, or I don't know, nautical miles, where they could see the land, because they were not navigators. The Moors, listen, the Moors are intelligent people. They're us. We would have stayed close to the land. We're not going to go through the belly of the beast, which is the Atlantic with the crazy currents. People are too wild. Our people are too wild. They want to act like it's all Negro, Africa. It's so be it. I'm not mad at you, but it's a dumb argument at this point. That is a deception. When they go, I'm from the tribe of Judah. Okay, you from the tribe of Judah. We all from the tribe. Everybody want to be from Judah. Nobody want to be from the other 11. Come on. I mean, prestige is in the 12, not the 1. But everybody want to be from Judah. Oh, well, Judah's the kings and queens. Oh, so now you try to, just like I said earlier, everybody want to be a priest. Well, I'm a Levite. Listen, you don't know what the hell you are. Matter of fact, you just learned who you were. Now, all of a sudden, you this, that, and the third? Come on. Let's just stick with the fact that all of this is ours. Let's continue to deal with the fact that we all collectively brethren and sistren. Let's stick with that and not worry about the landmasses because, again, the European has bamboozled and hoodwinked us on these names. This shit is not difficult. It's just not difficult anymore. Considering that it's the father's turn to move on the grand chessboard. And if fools want to sit around here and be part of the foolish nation and believe in what they doing and listen to what they saying and act like them, more power to you. This is a, and I said it many times before, this is a time for self-reflection, self-conviction, and self-correction. Because 2024 is right around the corner. 3 months. We don't even need to talk about their dumb false calendars of, oh, January is the new year, and in the dead of winter, it's the new year. We know that's lies and trickery, too. So at this stage in the game, if everybody still wants to utilize anything, I'm going to say it again, anything conceptually for reasonable truth that the Khazar and Germanic Indo-European has stated, then okay, be it as it may, don't be upset with the consequences. That's all I can say about that. Because this is not hard. It's just not hard to see anymore. It's not even hard to do. What is the hardest thing right now is consistency. See, it's just like a sport. You out here balling, and so you ball one game, and then the next game you're dud. No, coach is going to be like, yo, you got to be consistent. I mean, you go to school and you get a A plus on one grade, and you get an F minus on the next one. You know, your teacher's going to say, you're good, but you need to be consistent. So that's where we as a people got to continue to fight, and that's fighting against and for consistency. Righteous consistency against the unrighteous inconsistencies. That's what this is all about, being consistent in his word, in his ways, in his will. All this other bullshit is just bullshit. Oh, Jesus said that he's coming to save us. And this doesn't even make sense to me how they, Christians, want to say, oh, Jesus is going to, we want Israel, those people over there, to go ahead and, now this is fundamentalist, evangelical, crackerjack Christians, okay? They want to say, we need to support Israel over there, the Israelis, so that they can destroy and eradicate Gazians or the Philistinians or the Palestinians so that they can take over the land and they can rebuild the temple so that Jesus can come back and all will be honky-dory. But somewhere I'm missing something, because didn't the Messiah say that he'd come back with the sword? Didn't he say that everybody, ain't nobody going to be happy when he comes back? What kind of mad sorcery is this? Aha! It's that sorcery that we were under. This is why we know. This is that mirror. That mirror, and you know, the sister talked about it, Sister Pat talked about it the other day. This mirror, the man in the mirror, this is what they don't want to see. They can't see themselves. They will never see themselves for who they are. They will 988 themselves before they do that. And those very few that those very few out of the few many that the Father has chosen out of them, because see, that's the fullness of the Gentiles. The fullness of the Gentiles is when the Father has the final number of the Gentiles that he wants to cleave. That's that fullness. So it seems to me the Father's coming down to, you know, I can see him, you know, he's an accountant. He got, you know what I'm saying? He crunching numbers. He's like, ah, I come to the numbers. All right. And the Gentiles going, yay. No, what you need to do is not worry about them numbers that he crunching and make sure that you are found written in the book of life. And how's that? We're going to get into it. Aha, but first I wanted to touch on this real quick. Because this is where we are psychologically with the nations right now. And it's interesting, as because I was doing all this due diligence, I was quickly looking at some things, and this popped in, and I was like, wow, that's interesting. And it's Friedrich Nietzsche, the guy that they all hate, the philosopher that they say, that they say is just a bad guy. You know, they hate him. They don't like him. Let me see where is that at? Why did the U.S. not like Nietzsche? Watch this. Despite making his name as the greatest anti-democratic thinker of his age. Now, remember, democratic, you know, power of the people, which is a lie in and of itself, right? So he was against that lie. So the Democrats called him a communist, okay? Thinker of his age, Nietzsche believed that America was a, now watch this, believed that America was a land of free spirits, unburdened by the weight of the European past. Oh, how wrong was he? Because you got to remember, got to think of the time. Remember the time. He was at a time when they were still in their blessings. Although it was waning, unbeknownst to themselves and everybody else at the time, we can look back and say it was waning, but they were still in their blessings. Or rather, we were still in the curses, which allowed them not to be under the curses. That's how I'm going to start saying it, because they weren't even in the blessings, because to be blessed means that you're doing the right thing. They weren't even doing the right thing. They were just living it up. Oh, yeah. Right? So the America was a land of free spirits. Everybody over here was free except for us. Everybody's spirit over here in the Americas during that time was free. And he said they were unburdened by the weight of the European past. Oh, how wrong was he? Because they kicked it up a notch. Let me see something. They kicked it up a notch, and they went all in on Rome. This is the revived Roman Empire. Nietzsche? Yeah, yeah. See, he was at a time. So he was born in 1844 and died in 1900. Okay? So he didn't even see the First World War, but he probably was around the grumblings of it. He didn't really see the overtaking of the Zionists. You know, this guy was around the time of Albert Pike, when they were foreshadowing when they were systematically setting up. Albert was on one hand, on the other side, setting up the Masons, the European Masons here in America to solidify the wealth in America. And Friedrich was on the other side of the pond doing the same thing from a different perspective. But Friedrich was saying, yeah, they're unburdened by what we've been dealing with, what happened to us over here. But they really weren't, because they were doing the same practices that they had, that they were doing over there, over here. Everything. You know, it's interesting. Willie Lynch, you know, the King Leopold letter that Brother Judah was talking about today. I mean, that could, I mean, that sounds similar to the Willie Lynch letter. So all of this stuff is based on philosophical sorcery. And these people were philosophers. Albert Pike, philosopher, what's that dude? The guy, Shakespeare, who they say, the guy who they say, not Baron, Bacon. Something Bacon. I was going to say something Bacon. Something Bacon. Francis Bacon, I think. Well, whatever. These are all philosophers that changed the conceptualization of reason of Europeans. And it's easy to do for them because they are followers. And they all know that. Those, you talk about sheep, they're the original sheep. They're the original sheep because they're so gullible to believe that they are better than others in every way based on the capitalization of the world that they took over, that today they're struggling with this. It's like when I read, okay, so I'm done with that. I just, wait. This is it. So this is, I'm just going to read this one little part of Friedrich Nietzsche on the genealogy of morality. This is page, this isn't even, oh goodness. On Nietzsche's critique of morality, good, bad, and evil. This is the introduction, the fate of bad conscience. So, and I didn't even want to get all up in this, but this just stuck out to me. It says, Nietzsche opens the second essay by drawing attention to a paradoxical task of nature, namely that of breeding an animal that is sanctioned to promise and so exists as a creature of time, a creature that can remember the past and anticipate the future, a creature that can in the present bind its own will relative to the future in the certain knowledge that it will in the future effectively remember that its will has been bound. For this cultivation of effective memory and imagination to be successful, culture needs to work against the active force of forgetting, which serves an important physiological function. The exercise of a memory of the will supposes that the human animal can make a distinction between what happens by accident and what happens by design or intention. And it also presupposes an ability to think casually about an anticipated future. Okay? Nietzsche makes explicit that what he is addressing is the long history of the origins of responsibility. No wonder they hated him. So the sanction, the breeding an animal that is sanctioned to promise. Now hear those words. Namely, like this is the paradox task of nature. And he's saying nature, right? Because they thought that they were in control of nature. They thought they were supreme, right? They thought because they came last to the game and they were thinking very deeply and they wouldn't let us read during this time to be able to think reasonably and have our own intuitiveness about ourselves to stand in great joy and confidence. They thought that was all theirs. They are talking about us, three-fourths, three-fifths, not a human. Breeding an animal that is sanctioned to promise, okay? Sanctioned in the social sciences is a reaction, or the threat or promise of a reaction, okay? So it is a promise of a reaction to an action, sanctioned to promise, okay? So why am I even going to, because all of that is where we are. This is, we have come to where we are remembering our will, and we're remembering it being bound, and we are taking our bounds, those bounds off of our will. Now our will is now back to being free. The nations have never seen in over a millennia a free-willed Israelite. That is a scary phenomenon to their psyche. And they don't even, in seeing it, just to view that, to see it, that they have never had the wherewithal, capability, care to see, it is vexing them. It's like when you take 2 9-volt batteries and you put them together, negative, negative, positive, positive, you can feel the, when you take 2 magnets and put them, the sides that do not magnetize, you can feel that. This is what they're feeling. They're feeling that. And that's a slight pressure. And they don't know where that pressure is coming from. And today, some of them, based on the will and grace and mercy of our Father, is allowing them to know what that pressure is. And some of them are waking up going, oh my goodness, I know what that pressure, oh, is that, whoa. And they're coming over to us. And our testament is going to be how we receive them, because this is all action, reaction, reaction, action. Move, counter move. Okay? And this whole point brings me back to Baruch. Brings me back to Baruch. Second Baruch, 26 through 30, the 12 woes that are to come upon the earth. Because as we remember, they remember. But they'll just remember late. And the reason why they remember late is because they're not going to have any time to get it straight. Okay? And when I'm talking, I'm not talking black and white. That's stupid. That's a distraction in this. Now, granted, they created that black and white to deceive themselves. But it's not deceiving us, because for me, my antennas are sharp, okay? My antennas are sharp to know if you are one of the good guys or one of the bad guys. If you with me or against me. If you love me or if you hate me. If you have understanding, overstanding, or you do not. That's what I've been sharpening. You know, I go downstairs, and we got these sharp knives. We went and bought these Japanese knives cut from Japanese samurai swords. And, you know, they're lovely, but the only thing is you always got to sharpen them. So I always sharpen them. Like almost every day, but I do it like at least once a week. I'll get them, sharpen them, because that reminds me that I have to be sharp. Because the moment that I allow my knives downstairs to be dull, and then I go to get ready to cut my my tomatoes and my radishes and my cucumbers and my onions for my salad, and it's dull, and then I got to turn around and do it anyway, I'm wasting time. I don't have time to sharpen and then cut. I want them to be ready to cut. I want them to be sharp, ready to cut when I'm ready to use them. And that's how we got to be. This is us doing this. We are constantly sharpening our swords where they have allowed their swords to be dull and rusty. That's why they are now coming up, you know, walking up to the ledge talking about, golly, them fools over there don't seem to be the people with a book. They don't even fit anything. I don't know if I can go over this ledge if I want to take the dive because I see a bunch of niggers down there. I don't know. I don't know if they're going to catch me or not. Well, if you take the dive, that would mean that you have faith enough to understand that we your people. And if you don't take the dive and you stay with those folks that you think are your people, then you suffer the same fate. You suffer the same kind. Don't be mad. the payback. Don't be mad. Lord have mercy. Great balls of fire. And this section here goes to, this ain't going to be no quick and fast, hurryful thing. This ain't going to happen overnight. You know, as much as brothers, these brothers who love to talk about Africa and you know, we're going to get this. Listen, this is a slow marinade. The father over here making great marinade. His marinade is, and it takes time. It takes time. They forced their time on us. And the father's like, okay, you can take the amount of time that you do to bring my people to dry bones will be the amount of time I take to bring you to dry bones. Okay? So, And I answered and said, will that tribulation which is to be continue a long time, and will that necessity embrace many years? And he answered and said unto me, into 12 parts is that time divided, and each one of them is reserved for that which is appointed for it. In the first part, there shall be the beginning of commotions. We've had this. This has already happened. And in the second part, there shall be slayings of the great ones. It's already happened. And in the third part, the fall of many by death. Already happened. And in the fourth part, the sending of the sword. Already happened. And in the fifth, and the withholding of rain. And in the sixth part, earthquakes and terrors. The eighth part, wanting. Let's go back. Let's look at that word, because this is an important word right here for us. I've done this before, but we're going to reiterate this here, so that it's very, very clear. What just happened? Wait. What just happened? Oh. I mean, wanting, missing, lacking, inadequate, unequal, deficient, so... In the eighth part, there's going to be a lot of lacking. There's going to be a lot of dismissing. There's going to be a lot of it's going to be wanting. There's going to be a lot of lacking at that point. And
I mean, 20th century, 19th century, hello. It's already happened. Nine. And in the eighth part, and in the sixth part, earthquakes and terrors. And in the seventh part, wanting. And in the eighth part, a multitude of specters and attacks of the Shadim. Okay, so now we're getting closer to the now. All right, so in the ninth part, a multitude of specters and attacks of the Shadim, which is interesting. You know, you look at these Catholics and they run around, they got the everything, every horror movie about the nun or priest, I got to do an exorcist. How are you going to do an exorcist when you ain't even dealing with the right Messiah? What the hell kind of nonsense is this? I mean, how are you going to do an exorcist? And can Satan cast it? Why, Satan don't cast out Satan? It's stupid. So you got the nuns. The nun, nun two, nun three, you know. Insidious. You know, it's so mind-boggling that if these people were so moral, so righteous, so great, And they were the people, their church was righteous and it was doing the right thing. Ish was righteous and they were the people and they were doing the right thing. And Islam was and Muhammad was right and he was doing the right. If all of that was true, why the filth blarn is this filth blarn world in the predicament that it's in? So the same thing, so you can see how the exchange situation has occurred. So the same thing they would do to us when we were all downtrodden and bewildered, wanting, where's your God, nickel? Where's your God? Mocking us and our God. Now we kind of get to do the same thing, but we ain't even worrying about them because we already know, just like they already know. They already knew. They already know. We now already knew, and we already know. That's why the game is afoot. The Father, what they had us believing for a long time was that they had the next move. They don't have the next move. Their last move was the Inquisition. Why? Because that brought fear, death, murder all throughout the earth. That was their last move. That's when they took off all of the Father's pawns, wiping them out. They destroyed a castle, right? Jerusalem over yonder, they destroyed it, trampled it down, right? Took out all the bishops. I'm a Levite, I'm a priest, you know, wiped them out. Oh, no, they hid. They went underground. Okay, whatever. They ain't here. They're gone. They're off the board. You see? So all these, it's the Father's move. Well, and you know, the interesting part is there is no getting, like there's nothing they can do about that. They can't rush him because you don't rush it. You know, that guy can take as long as he needs if it's his game. And it's the Father's game. They came to play. The Father said, okay, here we go. And they chose to do that thinking that they had old Sammy, as Sister Pat said, went to said in their ear, hey, I could tell you might have a chance. I'll tell you, you may have a chance of beating the Father. Whispering this in their ear, deceiving them. And now they got brothers, oh, well, you know, the laws are done away with. Come on, man. That's stupid. That's, again, that is their conceptualization. And then nothing of that has happened in fruition. And because that has not happened in fruition, we can deem it a lie. I mean, shoot, they make you stand by your by their laws. Why would I go to the court? I got to go to court for whatever, you know, something dumb, whatever. I don't, I'm not even gonna put that on me. But let's just say I got to go sit in front of one of their judges, and I go to their judges, and he's like, I'm gonna pass a law and judgment. I said, whoa. Your law is done away with. I mean, you think he's going to be okay with that? And the other thing is that these people are not even mocking us. They're mocking our Father. Look how ignorant they are to mock the Creator. Oh, there is no God. You know, I don't know what you're talking about. Ish is the people. You know, you guys ain't nothing. You know, but all this... To do something against a being's people shows either you've got a lot of kahunas or you ain't got none. Or you ain't got none. And I'm sure from their perspective, they thought that they had some big kahunas. But it's actually being found out that they don't really have any. That's why they're doing it, because they don't have any. They just, they kahuna lists. Running around to and fro, seeing who they can devour, just like their daddy, who, mind you, had no balls at the end of the day. I digress, but let me move forward. And in the eighth part, a multitude of specters and attacks of the Shadim, the spirits. And in the ninth part, the fall of fire. See, we're getting closer. Maybe this fall of fire, I mean, we've had a lot of... comets come through. You know, we've got Pluto up in the sky. We got the red Kachina. We got the blue Kachina. We got the twins sitting around us. You know, there's a lot happening. Well, the fall of fire could mean a lot. And in the 10th part, rapine and much oppression. That's still happening. Look at how they have oppressing in the, it's still in the African continent, still over in India. Still over in China, still over in North Korea, still over in South Korea, still all over the world, still in America, in the Americas, still in South America, Central. Lots of rapine and oppression. Hold on a second. Rapine and oppression. That's happening today. Rapine, by definition, R-A-P-I-N-E, is the violent seizure of someone's property. The violent seizure of someone else's property. You can't make this stuff up. I mean, we, and it's funny, like they look at these scriptures and they look at it for, oh, well, that happened in Babylon, you know, back in Babylon, that happened in, you know, and all that stuff's already happened. Or, yeah, but everything goes in cycles. So when we read it, it's living. When they read it, it's dead. This is why their churches are done. Their churches and their pastors, they're kaput, they're fooey, they're gone, because they cannot bring forth the living word. Only those that are alive in Yahusha can bring forth a living word, because the word itself has to be living in you in order for it to be alive. And if you are dead, hence why we were dead, and we were over in the Christian church looking for life amongst the dead. The dead leading the dead. And in the 11th part, wickedness and unchastity. And in the 12th part, confusion from the mingling together of all those things aforesaid. For these parts of that time are reserved and shall be mingled one with another and minister one to another. For some shall leave out some of their own and receive in its stead from others. Those are those that's cleaving. And some complete their own and that of others, so that those may not understand who are upon the earth in those days, that this is the consummation of the times. So, the consummation of the times is, drum roll please, is that those may not understand who are upon the earth in those days. What days? The days of the woe number 12. You can't make this up. Stuff is just flowing. Woo! I mean, the Father is on fire now, and it's great the way we can just pick these things out now. You know, shoot, the 66, the 66. Listen, if you want us to beat you over the head with the 66, all right, shoot. If you want us to beat you over the head with the 80, all right, shoot. If you want us to beat you over the head with your philosophy, your history, your science, your economics, your information, your education, your politics, your rationalities, so be it. Because now this is they've never seen us, they never heard us, and now we standing up. It's something to be said about that in Ezekiel 37, where he said, man, you stand up a mighty, exceeding and mighty army. To them, they're looking at us like these niggas is the problem. Why? Because we saying that we're the people of the book. So that's a problem. You would think that that would be of great joy to you. Oh, finally, thank you, Father. We found the people of the book. Now we can be partakers of your kingdom. Nah, that ain't what they're saying. They're like, yo, this is a problem. These young Negroes who are saying that they are who they are, and see, young to them, because remember, these people who are saying these things are 80 plus. They living on a prayer. They old as Methuselah. So as old as they are, people that are 50, 60, they young. They have no conceptualization of what young is. It is relative to them. Listen, we are on straight fire. We went through the ring. This whole change of situation, you know, the exchange, you know, they're not gonna pass the baton willingly. So the Father's gonna do it. So therefore it's gonna be a change of situation, an exchange of situation. All of this is happening right underneath their eyes, right before their eyes, right underneath their noses, and they are perplexed, vexed, and they are running to and fro like chickens with their head cut off. And it's to be expected. And again, I ain't mad at them. If one of them stops running long enough, going to and fro, and they come up and they go, hey, brother, can you enlighten me on this? I got no qualms about it. I'm going to do it. Because for one of them to do that, or for anybody to do that, but let alone them to do that, that would mean that the Father has sent them. That would mean, because this time is the 12th woe. It's a commingling of madness. So for anybody to come up to us and start a conversation, or if the Father says go to them and say something, and they are receptive through from the action that we have provided them in a positive way, we need to take care of them. We need to take care of them. That's all that is. I mean, because if the Father sends them over to us and they're asking questions, well, man, I got time for you, man. You who the hell are you, man? You ain't even on my level. You need to back up. You need to go sit down. You need to, matter of fact, you need to go ahead and pay to take my course, and you can be part of my group. See, that's the Father's not going to take kindly to that. He's not. Because this is all a test. We ain't won yet. We will win, because that's what was written. But we ain't won yet. We still have to get to the kingdom. That's the prize. But the whole time you got these demon heads popping up. Surprise, nigga! Come over here. Come by this door. Come by over here. Go over there. Listen to me.
you know. So we are bad about it, and this thing is for them. It's about to put them down in a way that they're not. They're just not going to be able to recoup. They're not going to be able to get back, snap back from that. So we move forward. The fullness of the Gentiles be come in. The fullness of the Gentiles is the time when Gentile dominion on the earth ends and the visible theocratic kingdom on earth once again begins. So the theocratic kingdom is the Father's kingdom. See how they try to, you know, they could have made it simple. You know, the Gentile dominion on the earth ends and the Father's kingdom begins. See? Or Jacob's kingdom begins. I mean, or David's kingdom begins. Like, they could have said these things, but they don't, because if they say these things, it invokes a different spirit against them. When a theocratic kingdom on earth ended with the departure of the glory of the Father before the Babylonian captivity, as described in the book of Ezekiel, the Hebrew Bible from that time. When the theocratic kingdom on earth ended with the departure of the glory of the Lord, is what it says, of the Lord. And then it says, in parentheses, before the Babylonian captivity, as described in the book of Ezekiel, the Hebrew Bible from that time forward then referenced Gentile powers as the referent of time. The Gentile rulership, when the theocratic kingdom on earth ended, had began at the time of the Babylonian captivity and continues to this day. And therefore, the fulfillment, fullness of the times of the Gentiles awaits a future day when the visible theocratic kingdom will once again be established on earth. That is their problem. They want to see this kingdom. They do not understand that the kingdom is in us. And we build the kingdom. We manifest the kingdom. This is something that they have never seen. They've all heard about it. You know, they put it in their comics, in their movies, on their radio shows, on their, you know, in their pontifications, in their educations, whatever. You know. But they never seen it. So that's why he said, when I crack these skies, all nations will see. Because they need to see Yeshua. And again, it's a surprise. How's it go? Surprise, surprise. He going to be black, so-called. He going to be dark. And they're going to hasten to hate him, and he's going to destroy them all. And it just is what it is. And, you know, they always, everybody's going to be. No, listen, no, sir. This is not an everything and everyone and everybody situation. This is a situation on only those that have endured to the end will win. That's it. I mean, that's a task in itself. Let's see if I can get to it. Because this is where we're at, you know. And they always want to talk about, this is the deliverance of the church by Christ. This is what they want to be talking about. And at that time shall Michael, I'm sorry, this is Daniel 12, right? And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince, which standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was seen there begin to be a nation unto that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book. What's the book? The book of life. And many of them that sleep in the dust that are dead shall wake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and perpetual contempt. Wait, I thought everybody gets in. I thought everybody got a ticket. I thought great God was going to let everybody sleep in his heaven. I mean, this is why they don't read. They just take bits and pieces out and use it for their own gain. That's why it's
stupid to listen to them, because at the end of the day, they don't even read full chapters. And it's so funny that they judge us so harsh on reading chapters. Oh, you got to read that book. Well, let me get a book quiz, a book essay. You got to do this. You got to do that to get through this school. You got to have this amount of reading credentials and got a little. And I'm going, but you don't even read this thing, this thing that you say you are. That, you know, they stop right here, and thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book. Oh, hallelujah, we are saved. But wait, did you continue reading? No. Right? And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness shall shine as the stars forever and ever. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book to the end of the time. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. Then I, Daniel, looked, and behold, there stood other two, the one on this side of the brink of the river, and the other on that side of the brink of the river. And one said unto the man clothed in linen, which was upon the water of the river, when shall be the end of these wonders? And I heard the man clothed in linen, which was upon the waters of the river, when he held up his right hand and his left hand unto heaven, and swear by him that liveth forever, that it shall tarry for a time, two times and a half. And when he shall have accomplished to scatter the power of the holy people, all these things shall be finished. Scatter the power of the holy people. How is Christianity a scattered power? It's a consolidation of power. Yes, there's multitudes of Christian denominations, but there's only Christianity and Catholicism, and then you're Orthodox. So there's no scattered power in that. All the power rests on Rome. Or rest with Rome. All these things shall be finished. Then I heard it, but I understood it not. Then said I, O my Lord, what shall be the end of these things? And he said, go thy way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed to the end of time. Many shall be purified, made right, and tried. But the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall have understanding, but the wise shall understand. And from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away, and the abominable desolation set up, there shall be 1,290 days. So they took away our sacrifice, 70 AD, and then Rome came to power, right? Blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to 1,335 days. But go thou thy way till the end be, for thou shalt rest and stand up in thy lot at the end of the days. I mean, you know, where you at, Christians? I just don't understand how. Well, Jesus came to do away with that. You know, he said he done did away with their law. He said that the law's done away with. Hold on, where did I get that? You know, so. The laws are done away with from their perspective. So all of the prophets, all of the laws are of no consequence. I mean, that's so deep. None of the laws matter. None of them matter. None of the prophets have any respect out of these people. See, that's a mocking of our Father. The law is done away with. Jesus came. So you mean to tell me that Jesus died for you to sin? But there again, you murdered your Jesus, our Messiah, so that you could sin? Is that what you're telling me? Because it doesn't make sense how you're telling me today that the laws are done away with. Well, we already know that you can't do away with the laws. They're not yours to do away with. Like, what the hell is this? Like that's how you know we're under a foolish nation, because they had us fooled into believing what they were saying made sense. It just doesn't make sense. Oh, I know Moses said this. I know Abraham. I know Peter. I know Paul. I know all these apocalyptical writings that they wrote, Baruch, Edras. You know, I know all of that, but none of them matters because the law is done away with. Oh, just like that? Yeah. You ain't got to worry about that Old Testament or none of that stuff no more. Matter of fact, there's a new covenant made with the church. Well, really? Yeah. You didn't hear about that? You didn't hear the good news, brother? You didn't hear the good news? Well, what's the good news? Oh, Jesus died for your sins. Oh, really? He died for my sins? Yeah. Really? Because last I read, I thought Rome murdered him for the salvation of his people. Ah, you're going off. You're racist. You're perversing the word. This is why we just need to stand still. We don't need to deal with anything that they dealing with today. That means Israel, Gaza, we don't really need to be bothered with it. Their debt ceiling, we don't need to be bothered with it. Their voting, we don't need to be bothered with it. Their education, thought processes, their fear, their philosophies, their, holidays. That's needless to say, just their reasoning. I'll say it like that. We don't know. We should no longer be dealing with their reasoning at all. At all. And, I stopped dealing with reasoning, although I do give a moment of my time to brothers and sisters who still believe that we're all from Judah and we're all from Africa. I even give a moment of time to entertain them, but not much, because that too is deception and they are being deceived and I want to know parts of their deception. To me, it's just time for us to really cut away the fat. Like, we now know a lot. Like, we know so much more than the Gentiles and the heathens, the other nations, even some brothers and some sisters know today. And although we're not boasting and we don't carry or nor conduct ourselves in a poor character perception, nor do we impose our understanding onto anyone, we do realize that a fight has begun, or that the fight has begun, and we realize that the war we're winning. And when we take our time and look at the Father and let the Father do what he's going to do, like he told us to do, like he said he would, like he told us to do when he said stand, be still. Jacob, be quiet, rest. Those are signs and words for us to be at peace. That's what all that's about. And the most beautiful thing in the world is a breakdown of our redemption from us. From one of us, from one of our own. It is the most beautiful sound in the world, because it resonates. It resonates. That's why, their reflections echoes loudly from their past, and they are in fear of what they hear. That is where they are. And yet we are in Goshen. We are in Goshen. We are in the middle road
of Goshen, of peace. And it feels good. You know, some of our people, our family is going to be dealing with these crazinesses over the next couple of days. Okay, you know, just take the time that you have been given to rest, be at ease, and be at peace, and just enjoy yourself. You know? There's no reason anymore to be uptight. The Father has blessed us. We are alive. We are awoken. We are written in the book of life. Think about that. If you have awoken at this moment, can you be sure of a surety that you are written in the book of life? No. But can you believe you are written in the book of life? Absolutely. Because why would the Father wake you up for him not to want you to be in the book of life? Because as we can see, and see, this is how we reason. As we can see that they aren't even up yet. And those that are still got that sleep in their eyes, don't really quite, the foggy brain, the morning brain, right? Because they ain't even where we at. Mentally, we can go toe to toe. Like right now, I can go toe to toe with the Pope. I can go toe to toe with a lot of these Bidens. Oh God, he'd be beat down, you know. And but I'm just saying that on a big level. But I mean, just on the local level, shoot, these guys, these people around here, they'll get toasted, roasted. They won't even know what hit them mentally. And I know that to be true because I still play ball. And I did play ball with some of these guys that are in the top echelon of this area. So, you know, and they can't handle my intellect. And that's not me boasting. That's just reality. That's the glory and beauty of being in the presence and walking and seeking after the Father. And in seeking after the Father by our Messiah's way, the right way. So, all, you know, there was other scriptures I really wanted to get into. But, you know, I'm a little over. You know, Isaiah 41 is very, very good. It was telling. It more confirmed the point tonight. I read Daniel 12. You know, Matthew 5. Hold on a second. Wait. Is this what I wanted? Mm-hmm. Yep. What is killing? Wait a minute. Yeah, so Matthew 5 is the epitome of how we can just, like, this is like an uppercut, you know, not even, this is like a straight jab. This one right here, Matthew 5, the whole thing to the nations. It's a jab because, you know, they, once again, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. See, this is how they do, like, yeah, so. Let me go back. Isaiah 41, Matthew 5, Psalms 101. You know, and they'll go, oh, well, that's just when David was saying excuse me, oh, that's David describing what type of government he would want. Listen, this is the type of, David will have the government at the end, fools. David will have the government at the end. So when we're talking about living word, this is living today as it was then. It is a consistent word of life. The Gentiles see as, oh, that was then. See, that's dead. That's gone. That's done to them. That's why they're going to be side. They're going to have whiplash. Like, they're going to be side swiped. They're going to be T-boned with the truth. And it's going to hurt bad on them. I don't want to be nowhere near it. But when it happens and it's told to me and my spirit says it is done, I'm not going to, I don't think that I'm going to shed a tear, but I will be glad that their pain is over. That's how I say it. That their pain is over. Because the pain that they had, they imposed upon all of us. And the pain that they still have, they impose upon all of us. Look at Ish. He over there got pain of two people got killed or whatever after he done killed millions. And he's over there, oh, two people got killed and I'm pained. And now everybody has to pay. Like this, a Bullwinkle cartoon type deal. Everybody's got to pay for my pain. So, you know, I'm not going to shed a tear, but I'll be glad that their pain is over because obviously they can't handle pain. That's why it's going to be tough on them. And then it was Jeremiah 51, which I read. I read 8. This is, we would have healed her. Excuse me, we would have healed her, but she did not want to be healed. And that is so, so true, whereas she does not want to be healed. She does not want to, so there's no reason for us to kick against the prick and hurt ourselves and bring ourselves to a low, down to a low vibration and a low estate. Since we know the end game and we know that she does not want to be healed, then there is no reason for us to entertain her anymore, considering it is the Father's move. And we are being set up as the last two knights to take over the board. So, you know, be at peace, Israel. Be at peace. This whole thing is coming to a head for them quicker than they ever could imagine. Time has you know, reminds me of the Steve Miller Band. Time keeps on slipping into the future. Well, the future is tomorrow, or the future is in a minute at 11:10. You know, they made a preponderance of the whole thing. They created a problem, an issue with the whole thing because they'd be like, oh, well, the future is next year. Well, fool, you ain't even, you don't have control over the next 5 minutes, let alone next year. But when we were cursed, they were able to do that. They were able to do that because the time was slowed down. That's what they've been doing. They've been fixing time, and time is only relative within the mind of the people that deal with the time. So now that we're starting to see that time is full of doo-doo, okay, that, oh, daylight savings time, 1 minute it's sun's out till 8, and now all of a sudden, you know, the next 2 days the sun's down at 5. Well, I can explain that scientifically, pontification. I don't care about what you're talking about. You're trying to manipulate time. That's what the Book of Maccabees said. So at the end of the day, you are of no consequence to me any longer.
And this is the end of the matter. This is the end of the matter. It's the father's turn. He chose Jacob. And Jake and his progenitors or his descendants are here. Here we are. Hey, here we are. Hey, here we are. And we ain't mad about it, and we don't care if people don't want to believe. That's not our problem. And, you know, I just hope that, you know, some of the Christians who call themselves Christians and believe themselves to be Gentiles and believe themselves to believe that Jesus coming back is going to be a good thing for them, I hope they wake up in time to realize that that is a sinking ship. And Ish, all my brothers and sisters of Ish, who I grew up with, you know, I'm mad at you. You know, I got nothing but love for you, as I did then, as I do now. You know, what my issue is them people over yonder who believe that they are, yet they are not. And if you knew this, it is now time for you to stand up, Ish. If you want to support the true people, you know, it's time for you to do so. And for all the people who are kicking Christianity and Judaism to the curb and jumping over to Muhammad, I hope that you all recognize that Isaac was the chosen one of your era, and his sons, in particular Jacob, is the chosen one for this era. And you get back on track as a brother to us, for us, the rightful heirs to the land of Shem. If not, so be it. Nobody's mad. Nobody's upset. Ain't nobody going to do nothing. It's the father's move. We ain't going to do nothing. We ain't going to fight you. Whatever. If you don't believe it, so be it. Keep it moving. But don't be mad at them dare consequences. And that's really it. Choose wisely, because your reflections echoes loudly from your past, and you are in fear of what you hear. All praises to our Elohim, the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. To the nation, I give big ups, and I thank you for taking the time to hear this. For all the other nations that are thinking, wanting, and hoping to cleave, come on. It reminds me of that, now that P. Diddy is all jacked up, reminds me of when Suge said, you know, I think at one of those awards, he said, if you don't want to be, you know, part of a group that, you know, the producers all up in the videos, you know, dancing and stuff, come on over here. You know, so if you're tired of your pastor and priests and popes and imams and all these rabbis all shucking and jiving, lying, cheating, stealing, you know, come on over here to the righteous side. We'll take care of you as long as you take care of us. So all praises, again, as I said, you know, and this is all about the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. If people ain't talking about the God, the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, well, then we don't know. They ain't with us. We're talking about that Elohim. We're not talking about Rome's Elohim, Saudi's Elohim, China's Elohim,
anybody else in the so-called Elohim, we talking about our Elohim, the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. All praises. Shalom.
The need for foster parents locally in North Carolina and all over the country has been unmet for years. Thompson Child and Family Focus is transforming lives through early childhood, family stability, and mental health services. No matter the situation of a child, you can come to Thompson for the training you need to serve them. Discover how you can be a foster parent and make a difference in a child's life. Go to thompsoncff.org or call 704-536-0375.
The Pinehurst Southern Pines Aberdeen area of North Carolina is the home of American golf, but a place with so much more. Choose from a variety of quality local restaurants, quaint walking downtowns where you can discover unique shopping treasures, or explore more than 30 scenic trails to stretch your legs. Then cap it all off with a beverage from one of our many breweries or wine shops. Plus, with more than 300 annual events, there's always more to do in the Pinehurst Southern Pines Aberdeen area. For more, visit homeofgolf.com. That's homeofgolf.com.